Mr. Speaker, if you want to see a demonstration of slavish loyalty to the No Deal Brexit cult cause, you need look no further than these honourable gentlemen. This isn't just turkeys voting for Christmas, it's turkeys lathering themselves in cranberry sauce and shoving the stuffing up their own posteriors. I've got a feeling, though, Mr. Speaker, that this probably will be the last chance that we'll have the opportunity to see the presence of the right honourable gentleman in his place. He wanted a legacy, Mr. Speaker. How about the least successful leader of the House that we've ever had?
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm grateful, as always, to the honourable gentleman for his characteristic charm. Mr. Speaker, what we have seen today is, I think, in history, unprecedented, unknown, unseen. We have seen a frightened Scotsman. That people who are known for their courage, their forthrightness and their sturdiness, and they are scared of going in front of their own voters. They have run away from an election. They are, what is it, timorous beasties, I think they must be called, Mr. Speaker, who dare not face their voters. And I just wonder whether this is because of the narrow majority that the honourable member for Perth and North Perthshire himself has, and that he parades it as concern for Conservative members. He is worried that they may be in danger. But surely, if that is what he really thinks, he should be embracing this opportunity for an election, should be pushing forward for it. And he mentioned, as the Honourable Lady did as well, my right honourable friend, the member for Orpington, who has decided to leave Her Majesty's government. This is something that we know about across the country. Families disagree on Brexit. My enormously distinguished, wise and good sister, Annunciata, has gone and joined the Brexit Party, and not only joined it, but got elected to the European Parliament. So we all have, within our families, these disagreements over an issue that is of fundamental importance to us. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Is of fundamental importance to us all. And that is why it is right to put this back to the British people in a general election so they can decide, and so that the honourable gentleman can restore the honour of the people of Scotland by showing he is not afraid.
These are richly enjoyable exchanges. That would ordinarily be the case in the presence of the Leader of the House in any circumstance, but I believe that it is more so because, unless I am much mistaken, the Right Honourable Gentleman is not the only Rees-Mogg present and observing our proceedings today. And it's a great pleasure and privilege to welcome Little Moggs, in particular, of whom there are several, and other members of the Rees-Mogg dynasty. Notwithstanding that joy, one of the responsibilities of the Speaker is to safeguard the rights of members in respect of business to follow. And I make that point simply to underline the imperative of brevity from back and front benches alike, in observing that exceptionally today it may not be possible for everybody to be called on the business statement. We will do our best, and the quest for brevity can be led, I think, with distinction by Dr. Julian Lewis.